So we're here in Prismic Studio. I'm still with Tim, and we had several videos before where we talked about different things. But one of the things that we talked about is the fact that, you know, you can start with Next simply and you move on like to more, like you can start with just your pages, like if you would do with PHP, just the page file per page, and then you can add more dynamism with dynamic rendering. And yes. then we move to another thing is that you can write your APIs with Next.
Right. So something that we recently introduced is that you can do, so you can build your whole React application, but it's generally always front end, right? So you build your whole front end in React plus Next, for example, and that covers like all the front end needs that you have. Except like generally you have like more needs than just building the front end. For example, you have a checkout that has a payment API call that it needs to make. So what we recently introduced is having an API built into Next. So what you can do is you can create a directory inside of the pages directory. So pages slash API, and any file under there will become an API route.
Nice.
Which means that you can create the file, and the file is not like a React component, it's a request handler.
Right.
And it's based on Express, this request handler. So generally, if you ever used Express before, you do like .get and then like the route that you want to do. So like slash, for example, and then you have a handler,
right.
A function basically that gets request and response.
And then like if you so basically we run into this problem when we were like using Next, and then we thought like, hey, we need this kind of API, but that meant to us like we should start another node server, you know, or you know, you try to use the same node server and you know, different setup, different project, where it made sense to have to be in the same place, right?
So it's actually like that for most people. So what you end up doing is you create maybe you want to do like microservices, or like where every route is a different service or a different file or something like that. However, what you end up doing is if you want to like run your whole project, you have to boot up like maybe 10 servers, right? And you have to run them on different ports and then like try to stitch them together in some way. And
I can only imagine like if you're working in development in your
so
computer,
you're in
you need to run everything.
Like you're making changes and you're refreshing the, you're like running a curl to get, to try out your API. And then like, you're like, I made this change, why doesn't it work? And then like half an hour later, you figure out that you had to restart the server, for example, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in Next, we solve this by providing, like if you make a change, it's immediately updated. So if you do a new request, it's immediately going to be the new code that you wrote.
Mm-hmm.
And besides that, everything runs in one server in development. However, if you deploy it, you deploy it as serverless functions.
Nice.
So this means that every page that you, serverless API route that you make basically, it will be serverless, and it will be independently run and independently deployed.
Right. And like if I have, like the question that comes to my mind here is that how is that different from the old approach of having a monolith? And people, some people will say like, okay, you're writing everything inside the same project.
Right.
Is that a problem? I mean, of course, you give some hints that they're broken into several in the serverless sort of functions.
So it's kind of interesting, right? Because you are starting as writing a monolith, but it's actually not a monolith. Because in a monolith, like a classical monolith, for example, if you would like use PHP, you would have like one router that is inside of PHP. And then
what,
it looks like
a huge router, right?
For example, and then you take all those routes and you stuff them into the same file, so it executes like all your code every time you because the way that PHP works, for example, is every time a request comes in, it executes the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
So it would load all the code, and there's like some ways around that, but like in like older applications, it would be like that. And in a similar way, that's true for JavaScript too. Like every file that you add in or every dependency will slow down, for example, the boot up of the server.
That's more code to compile.
It's more code to compile and parse, etc. Yeah. However, the way that it works in Next.js is that every file becomes its own different lambda function, which means that you only bundle the code for that specific function, which means that it's not a very big... So you have an endpoint that does a payment request using any payment provider. This means that you would only like bundle maybe 40 KB or something, mm-hmm. right? Instead of like this whole, maybe you have 100 API routes. It would be like 100 MB if you like had everything in one server, which is what you would do with, for example, Express, if you don't split them out, for example, the routes.
And also not only about the size, I see that distributing it becomes easier. Like if you want things to run on the, since you're deploying them yes. on Lambda and on serverless, then by default, your system is distributed. Yeah. It doesn't run all on one machine, which means like there is isolation.
Yeah, and it's
right?
scaling in between. So every file that you have can scale independently of the other file.
And can be isolated.
Writes, right?
And
it's isolated. So
if you have one, it's taking yes. a lot of processes or a lot of CPU, a lot of memory, doesn't mean that the other will suffer from it. So you
yes.
have that kind of isolation that is very important in
yeah.
web apps as well.
Yeah, and it makes the profiling, for example, also easier because you have like
one thing that you're
to
looking at.
Profile. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, nice. Thank you very much for all these details.
Happy to.